Hey guys, welcome. We are so glad that you decided to join us here today. We're gonna start service off a little differently. As you notice, there's a few of my friends on stage. This is the CCV Kids Worship Team, here to do what only they could do. So, I dare you to do the moves along with us. Here we go. Come on, let's get it started.
Let's talk about a real game changer. I was losing till I surrendered. My missing piece was found in letting go.
Come on, let's sing this next part out.
I've been throwing up walls all my life. You tore them down, call me out into the daylight. Said I was never meant to do this on my own.
Let's get a little slow-mo.
If you don't know this about CCV already, please hear me. We're a church that wholeheartedly believes in the next generation, and we put our money where our mouth is. At the beginning of this year, God prompted us to do something radical. Amidst all the uncertainty in the world around us and the crazy inflation, we decided to drop the price of all of our camps, and we set a huge goal of getting 10,000 kids and students to sign up for camp. We even opted to host our high school camp for just $50. By the way, that's the same price it was when CCV opened its doors 40 years ago. Why did we take such a risk? Because we know that Jesus is the hope of the world. But the church doesn't have a future if we don't invest in the next generation and help them find Jesus. And we know one of the best places for life transformation to happen is at camp. And this weekend, we want to do two things as a church. One, we want to celebrate the incredible life change that happened at camp this summer. And we want to thank you, those of you that gave faithfully to our camp fund and those of you that volunteered at camp so it could even happen. The second thing I hope happens this weekend is we want to inspire you, no matter your generation, to make an impact on everyone you know around you to grow in their relationship with Jesus. Our camps were amazing, but they're only the beginning. And I hope this weekend you realize we all have a part to play in the rest of the story.
That's drifting. We're chasing a feeling, a place of belonging, a place we can let go of all of the shame that we borrow, and all of this searching has brought us to one thing. Let me hear you. Jesus, He's calling out. There's a seat at the table. Lay your burdens down. Say, enemy is given. Come on, we can do better than that. We're singing with angels. Can you hear the sound? Let me see you jump. Come on. From peasant to prince in the making, Your presence gives worth to our dreaming. But God's dream is better than scheming. So what? So riches and status we're leaving. The world's got nothing I'm needing. 'Cause the maker who came up with breathing is bringing us into His kingdom. There's a seat at the table. Lay your burdens down. Won't you lay them down? 'Cause heaven, we shout, is getting loud. We're singing with angels. Can you hear the sound? Can't you feel it? It's here and now. Heaven is here and now. We say, heaven's gates have swung wide. The veil between you and I is torn clean apart. We're back to the start. You're stepping into this space to bring us out of our graves, back to your heart. Oh, back to the start. Heaven's gates have swung wide. The veil between you and I is torn clean apart. Yes, it is. Hey. We're back to the start. Yeah, you're stepping into this space. Come on. Table, lay your burdens down. Won't you lay them down? 'Cause heaven, woo, is getting lighter now. We're singing with angels. Come on, can you hear the sound? Last chance, let's jump. Come on. Dude. Everything around me is shaking. I've never been more glad that I've put my faith in Jesus. And he's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail? Now listen. He won't. No, he won't. I've got joy. 'Cause I've still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense. And I won't be going under. I'm not held by my own strength. Let's go. 'Cause I've built my life on Jesus, and he's never let me down. He's faithful through every season. Hey. So why would he fail? Now say it. He won't. No, he won't.
CCV, we love worshiping with you. You sound amazing. Go on and take a seat. My name is Leon. I'm one of the pastors here. And let me start by saying, students, what's up? Yes. Man, it is so good to see you guys. And I just want to say thank you all for spending part of your weekend here with us. For those of you watching online, thank you for joining us. We are so glad that you are here. This weekend, we are celebrating what Jesus did in the lives of our kids and students, and let me tell you, we have so many stories to share, from crazy water slides at kids camp and special needs camp to major sunburns up at UCYC. I know, you know who you are, to just students losing their voices as they worship Jesus. This would be a summer that we will never forget. But there's one story in particular that I would like to share with you guys tonight. We had a student, she came to camp very skeptical about Jesus. She didn't know if she would be welcome. She didn't know if it was okay to have questions about Jesus. She's done some things in the past, didn't think that God's grace would be enough. She didn't know she could be forgiven. And one day at camp, she had a conversation with her two incredible coaches. And they walk her through what it means to follow Jesus. They answer some of the questions that she had. And those that they couldn't answer, they simply said, hey, let's figure this out together. And let's continue to have more conversations. That night at session, the message was all about God's grace and giving your life to Jesus. That night, she let go of everything. That night, she felt at home. That night, She understood that Jesus is not afraid of her questions. He actually welcomes them. That night, she gave her life to Jesus and experienced his grace. You can clap for that. You see, we have this idea in our minds that grace has everything to do with who we are, what we do, what we can accomplish. That's not true. Grace has everything to do with who Jesus is and what he did on the cross for you and for me. This is what Paul says in the book of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4 through 6. But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved. For he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ Jesus. Today, as we take communion together, let's remember to put our faith in Jesus. Let's remember that his grace is all that we need. Let's pray together. Father, thank you so much for allowing us to be here. Thank you for the just incredible gift that it is to be a part of a church that believes in the next generation. As we gather here today, we remember and celebrate your sacrifice and your love. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
I'm in Rocky Point, Mexico with my family, and we're staying in a hotel. It's about midnight, and my wife nudges me and pushes me and says, "Babe, someone's knocking at the door." We weren't expecting anybody at the time, and so I stumble out of bed, and I walk to the door, and I look through the hole, and I see that there's a man on the other side, but I don't recognize him. So you need to know some of the details about the situation. My wife, my son, and my daughter were in the room with us. I don't have any weapons to protect us. I don't speak Spanish. I actually don't even know how to call 911 in Spanish, which as it turns out is 911 for your future reference. And I have a decision to make in this real brief moment, and so you're gonna judge me, and I'm okay with that because I had to make a decision. And so I decided I am going to open the door. So I do just that. I open the door, and as I do that, a guy rushes in and pushes past me, and I push him back as hard as I can. And then we have this moment where he looks at me and I look at him. I'm in my boxers, he's fully clothed, and he realizes in that moment that he knocked on the door that he thought his friend was behind, and it was the wrong door. Would have been another flight up or down or something. And in that quick second, realized that he owed me an apology, and so he said he's sorry, and I accepted, and I said I'm sorry because I thought I was gonna push him over the rail, all 5'8" of me. And I then said goodbye to my new friend. I shut the door, tried to slow down my heart rate, and move on with the night. I wanna talk with you about the next generation. And there is an intruder that is pushing his way into the lives of our sons and our daughters. And I don't think I need to convince anybody of that. I think you can just look around and see what's going on in our world and feel the weight of what's happening. And there's a battle going on. Furthermore, I think that for most of us, we feel the weight of it, but at the same time, we feel a little helpless as to what we're to do. Like, how do we engage in this problem? What do we do? And I want to talk with you this weekend about this next generation, because I believe that many of us, we have desire for change, and we want more for our kids, we want more for our future, for the generations. We just don't know what to do. And I want to talk with you this weekend about how we can come alongside of the next generation as they fight for their faith. There's a letter written to a group of Christians, and these Christians are in a very progressive city. It's a large city, and it's dark, and it's godless. And they're receiving this letter because for so many of them, they're having a hard time like following through with their belief, and so many influences are pushing against them, and so they're not sure how to be Christian in this environment. And so a letter was given to them by a very noteworthy man. It's a guy that wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. Most prolific writer that we have is Paul. Paul's in prison at the time. He's in prison because of Jesus and because of his faith. And so he's writing this letter, this punchy, like powerful letter to this group of believers, kind of giving them some encouragement and some inspiration as to how they're gonna live their lives. And so this is not a normal letter. This has urgency behind it. This has like importance and significance behind it. You would, if you could be in the moment, I think we'd hear passion behind these words. And he's describing a battle going on in their city, and the battle's still going on. Last chapter of this letter called Ephesians, chapter 6, he describes this battle, and he says that it's not a physical one. It's a spiritual war, and you fight a spiritual war with spiritual weapons. Goes on to describe the types of weaponry we use as we face these wars in life. I want to zoom in on one specific line in the fourth chapter, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1, and he's writing from prison, and so he gives this greeting. He says, "As a prisoner for the Lord, I beg you to live a life worthy of the calling to which you've been called. I beg you, I plead with you, live a life that's worthy of the calling to which you've been called." Now, when you hear the word calling, as sometimes I think the same thing when I hear that word, I think about like occupational calling. Like there's a job assigned to that, that God's given me this specific role in life, and I get paid to do that, and that's my calling, or I have a passion that God's given me, and that's what he means by calling. But most of the time in the New Testament, that's not the case. What he's describing with calling is how we live out our faith, how we embody the character of Jesus within us. That is the calling he's describing. And he uses two different words. That's why you kind of see some redundancy there. It's one is a noun, one's a verb. He's saying this is your calling and you're called to this. This is who you are and what you do. What is that calling? He says it in the previous line. He says, live a worthy life. Our calling, if we're believers, if we're Christ followers, our job description is to live a worthy life. Which begs the question, what does that mean? What is he talking about? He's talking about living a faithful life following after Jesus. That's what it means to live a worthy life, to love God and love others. We stylize that around here as Christ-centered difference makers. You might have heard that. We talk about that a lot. That's another way of saying we love God and we love others, and we're just trying to follow Jesus. And we're trying to live this worthy life. But just before that, he uses an interesting word. We just read and it says, I beg you. Maybe some energy behind that, maybe some passion behind it, but it's more than that. It's more significant than that. That word, I beg, is actually a word that means to come alongside of and to partner with the worthy life. So see this worthy life, you're to come and associate with that and stay committed to that worthy life. And what's interesting is that word is in the same family as the word we get for Holy Spirit. So he's using Holy Spirit language here. What does the Holy Spirit do? The Holy Spirit comes alongside of us, supports us, guides us, comforts us. So he means more than just, hey, this would be a good idea to do this. He's imploring us to live a worthy life. And he's saying, I want you to come alongside of this. And I want you to know that you are a part of a church that is striving to come alongside of the next generation, our sons and our daughters, to come alongside of parents as we raise our kids in really cool and unique ways. If you were to pop into any one of our rooms, you'd see that we have over 10,000 kids and students on all of our campuses, which is really incredible. We have over 2,000 volunteers that invest their time every single weekend walking alongside of, exemplifying, and serving and loving our kids and our students. And why are they doing that? They're doing that to model and to be a part of showing them how to live this worthy life. They're doing that repeatedly. If you were to add up all of the hours that are poured into the next generation every year, it'd be over 100,000 hours worth of time, which is unbelievable. But it's beyond what we do in our programs. It's more than that. We've got a sports program we call STARS. This is not just for kids to play sports. There's other places where they can play sports. This is a place where they can start living out and have coaches that also model for them the worthy life, a life of faithfulness, because it's more than a game for us. This summer was like monumental. We had camp, and we have camp most summers except for 2020, and this was a powerful, powerful summer. We had over 10,900 that went to camp, and just an unbelievable experience. But what's cool about that is out of that number, there's over 1,300 kids and students that decided to follow Jesus for the very first time. So killer. You know, you see this door beside me, and one of the things we did at our junior high and high school camp is we invited students to come and walk through the door when they're ready to follow Jesus and put their life in his hands. And so we saw a lot of kids. In fact, we saw 380 so far get baptized since camp. And this is like 5 or 6 weeks. We're proud of this church. And what we're doing with mom and dad, we're trying to help. We're trying to partner with you. And we're coming alongside of you, as the word says, and helping the next generation live a worthy life. But I want to talk to you specifically. I want to talk with you about you, because some of you are thinking, that's cool. I don't know what I should be doing. Like, I see the church, there's these things, but what about us as individuals? What about us as parents? What should we be doing? And it's the same thing. It's to be coming alongside of, but this is what I want you to hear, is how we fight. How we fight alongside of the next generation is with our faithfulness. It's by living that worthy life. That's what we do. What does it look like? Well, when we fight, what do fighters do? Fighters pray. We pray for our kids. We pray with our kids. We pray over our kids. We fill our house with prayer. That's what a fighter does. Fighter leans on and lives out this truth. For some of you, I'm kind of this way too. I read a lot of my Bible through an app. And it's online. But do our kids know what our Bible looks like? Like, would they be able to identify where our Bible is? Some of us need to, like, knock the dust off that thing and put it on the nightstand so that it's visible again, so that the next generation can see that it's important. And it's beyond important. It's critical. It's our North Star. It's what we're leaning on. What does it mean to be a fighter? We serve. We serve in this church. We serve in our communities because we're trying to be an example to the next generation and show them what it means. Plus, besides that, it's about us too. It's about us following and being faithful to Jesus, regardless of who's around. But it's important for the next generation to see that in us and be a part of that. We do follow through well. That's what a fighter does. Fighter follows through. What they say and do, they match, because here's the problem. What ends up happening is when anybody sees discrepancies between like what someone thinks or believes and what they do, it starts to discredit that. And so when we see somebody that thinks they believe, but then their actions don't back that up, it starts to diminish their value and their impact. Some of you, I know you're wondering right now, like, I don't know if I can do that. That seems a little unrealistic for me. You don't know my story. You don't know the way that I've been raised. You don't know what I've done in raising kids. I want you to hear a story from a guy that was probably thinking about the same things and would have the same responses when it comes to living out this faithful life. His name's Ryan. Check out his story.
Before my dad found Jesus, he was not a very happy guy. He was very angry all the time. I wouldn't like look forward to coming over here because my dad was not like happy.
My mom and my grandparents raised me. My parents split up at a young age. My mom suffered from multiple addictions like over our childhood. All I had to ever rely on was myself. I never wanted to give too much to anyone because I knew it would be tough if they let me down, so I knew I was the only one I could trust. In my mid-20s and 30s, I lived for the ways of this world. Like, I filled my life with everything I thought was important. It was chasing jobs, it was chasing money, it was what I owned, like what I bought. My identity was in shoes, it was in cars, it was trucks, it was everything that didn't matter. The first 10 years of my kids' lives, I was busy working. Like, I figured if they had everything they wanted, I was a good dad. I missed many first steps, first days of school, plays, all of that stuff, because I thought money and status was more important at that point. At the age of 39, my ex-wife invited me to a CCV Jumpstart class with our daughters. And walking onto campus, I just thought to myself, like, man, I do not belong here. Like, I'm being judged. These people know that I'm not good enough to be here. And walking into the students' building at Peoria, one of the pastors on staff walked up, and the four words he said to me changed my life. He said, "We're glad you're here." Nobody had ever said, "We're glad I was anywhere." Walking out with my wife, I said, "Why don't we give church a try?" And this was like a July. So we decided we would go through December. And by week two, we had jumped into a small group. By the grace of God, the people in that small group were the exact people that God knew I needed. These people took me under their wing. They mentored me. They showed me what it was to be a Christ follower and a better father. And every week I could feel the heart change in myself. Like the heart of stone that I had lived with for so long had been removed and replaced with a heart of flesh. Six months passed, and I'd always wanted to be able to pour into high school students, and I got the opportunity to join CCV students in the high school ministry.
I was a high school coach for two and a half years, had a group of dudes that I poured into, and then all of a sudden I was challenged to join the residency, to go into full-time ministry. So I walked away from a career, a great paying job, a set schedule, to follow and be obedient to Christ. He was calling me to be able to pour into you guys. Like, I would have never expected 4 years ago that I would be standing here speaking to any of you. If you would have asked me, I would have told you you're crazy.
The stuff I've learned, the things I've been allowed to do are absolutely incredible and life-changing for myself and for my family. I've seen my daughters get baptized. I've seen my relationship with them change. And after finding Jesus and this heart change, I know that dating my daughters is important. Taking them out, having one-on-one time, spending that intentional time with them, and just getting to know them again. Before, somebody asked me, like, what was the greatest failure of my life? And I said the first 10 years of my daughter's lives, because I was present, but I wasn't there. I would play, I would hang out, I would do what they wanted if it was convenient for me. Like, now I have the opportunity to be a father, be present, and actually show them the man that they should be looking for when they're getting married.
I think my dad being so passionate about Jesus and like pouring it into all of us has made everyone just like so much closer as a family, and always knowing that Jesus is there for us.
From following my dad, my faith has grown. I used to not go to church. I was scared of it and I was nervous. I didn't know what to expect. I didn't think I belonged there. But seeing my dad, knowing about his past and seeing him go constantly and seeing that you can change and that God and Jesus accepts whoever with whatever has happened in your life, as long as you ask for forgiveness, it has helped me and shown me that I can also follow him and go to church and become a better person.
I mean, it actually fills my cup to know that I've had a positive impact on their lives, to hear that I have been a good role model, that I have done things somewhat right. Because you never know as a parent, sometimes you beat yourself up thinking, man, am I doing anything right? And to hear those words and to know that they do now want that relationship and they crave that relationship, and knowing that they have that relationship now is awesome. I love every second of it.
I want you to hear this, that faithfulness does not mean flawlessness. Some of you are beating yourself up and you're like, man, I could never get there and I could never be that. Let me encourage you. It's about starting every day new. We get mercies that are new every morning. You can start tomorrow, you can start today. When you find yourself falling off of where you were heading, you can get back on again, and you keep doing that. Keep striving for faithfulness. You know, I know there's some of you moms in here, and you are driven by guilt. You wish you could change a million things about the way that you've parented or what's going on with your kids, and I want you to know, don't be guided by guilt. Continue to remain faithful and preach in hope into your household. They need you. Some of you dads are discouraged because you don't feel like you have any influence in the lives of your kids. And maybe that's true for some reasons. But you can start again. and you can begin to build that up again. Stay engaged. You might feel like, especially if you have teenagers, you're like, my kids don't want to hear from me. I get it. I got those too. Stay engaged. They need to hear from you. They need you and they need your faithfulness. What's at stake? What's at stake? It's a generation. A generation is at stake. Whether you know this or not, someone is watching the way that you live your life and deciding what they're going to do with Jesus. Your kids, your grandkids, nieces, nephews, cousins, the weird kid down the street. Everybody's got a weird kid down the street. And they're watching the way that we live our lives. What are you going to do with your life? What are you going to do with your faith? Someone's going to make a decision to follow after Jesus and maybe even walk through the door in part because of the way that you follow Jesus. Guys, let's keep fighting. Let's be a church that fights for the next generation with our faithfulness.
For my faith journey, I would say definitely my mom. My mom's a big part of my first starting going to church. She told me a lot how God helped her through her hard times. And I went through hard times myself in middle school, and it showed me that God's faithful if you follow him, if you're actively pursuing him and doing what you're supposed to do. I was dead in sin. I was depressed, suicidal, cutting, mental health, all that kind of stuff. So without some kind of hope at the end of the tunnel, it has been a very meek life, a very dead life for me, and I want to say that if I had not had them, I'd probably be a dead man. That's just being honest, because I can't find a way to just say I'll be all right. No, just got to be honest about it. I would be a dead man. I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be able to make impact on the students here. I wouldn't be able to be the person I am today.
I'm done trusting in what's sinking. These boats weren't built for me. I'm done drifting on the water of insecurity. In the noise and the distractions, in the storms of arguing, I hear your voice calling. I'm gonna fix my eyes on Jesus, walking with the one who walks on the sea. Give my life to follow. Speak to me and I'll go wherever you lead, wherever you lead. I'm done worshiping an image of what only looks like me, surrounding you with what my eyes can see. God, would you forgive me? Restore the mystery. I hear your voice calling, calling. And I'm gonna fix my eyes on Jesus, walking with the one who walks on the sea. My life to follow. Speak to
if I'd be at the point where I am with Christ if it wasn't for my dad or my leaders. They've really impacted me. They've been my spiritual mentors, and they've just helped me get to the point where I'm at today.
So my junior high coaches were really impactful. Like, they were always challenging me with new questions and just made me think a lot about, like, my faith, and it helps me grow my faith a lot.
My parents shaped my faith by going to church and praying whenever things got hard. They never went away from him. They went closer to him and ran after him, and that's how I'm here.
My dad has always been someone that has pushed me to be where I'm at today, and some of my junior high coaches have always pushed me to be the leader that I am today.
And my grandma's someone who's really helped me, because she's like my best friend, and like anytime like I'm going through anything, she'll just find a way to bring God into it without like invalidating my feelings or saying like what you're going through isn't hard. Like, she'll just say like God has a better plan for you.
My dad, when they first started attending CCV, it was important for him to just be the role in the house to lead his entire family to church. Just the way he treated my mom as a husband, the way he treated my sister as a father to his daughter, and the way that he led me to grow up and be the man I am now, he's just been very Christ-centered in everything he's done.
Wherever you go, wherever you lead, that's where I'll go, that's where I'll be. The moment you call, the second you speak, that's when I'll go. Step out and believe.
Let me ask you a question. Where is Jesus leading you today? Is it for you to be more intentional at home? Let me tell you, I have three incredible kids of my own. That's something that I need to work on. So maybe it's time, is he leading you to serve in STARS, kids, special needs, or students? Talk to your staff tonight. So maybe time for you, is he leading you to give your life to him, for you to experience his grace? Tonight is your night. We're having baptisms after every single service this weekend, and we know there's a storm going on, but that's not going to stop us. We're ready to go in building 4,000. We have everything that you need right there. A storm will not stop us from celebrating what Jesus Christ is doing in our church. I have a friend of mine, Emma. She's an 8th grade student. Emma, come on up. She's going to be What's up, girl? Good to see you. Emma, would you mind praying us out?
God, thank you for that amazing message, and thank you for this time that we get to be here every weekend. And God, I want to say a special prayer for our students going back into school, that they can be Christ-centered difference makers to their classmates, teachers, inside and outside of school, on their sports teams and in their clubs. Help them to be a light and to make a difference and to get this valley excited for Jesus. Help us to glorify you through our words and actions wherever we are. I pray this all in your name. Amen.
Amen. CCV, we love you. We will see you next week. Take care.